Good evening. My name is Adam Walden. I'm the publisher of .next magazine. As some of you may be aware, Liam Dowd, our executive editor, was supposed to be here tonight in a moderating capacity, but unfortunately Liam is taken ill, so you'll have to make do with a lowly publisher this evening. .next magazine. If you don't know the name, you will. We're an online business journal set to launch in January of 2016. We want to create discussion that pushes beyond cyberspace into actual space. To this end, we've been very pleased to partner with several colloquii at the vanguard of the arts and sciences in North America, something we're calling Conversations with Tomorrow. Last month, we presented the meta virtual reality pioneer, Dr. Arun Vogel, at the Cognate Labs Triennial in St. Paul, Minnesota. In September, we will be bringing Sindelbit Rao to the Van Allen Writers Conference in Athens, Georgia. And of course, in November, we're thrilled to have both Jeremy Sachs and Virgil Esposito together joining us at the Ideas West Conference in Mendocino, California. And of course, we're very happy and very proud to be here tonight, co-sponsoring tonight's lecture with the Summerworks Performance Festival, Great Paintings, Gross Profits, by Mba Fabrications President and CEO, Donald Ian McCaw. It's no insider information that our economy and our society is in the midst of rapid change. It is an unstoppable process, not because it is the result of some grand master plan, but for precisely the opposite reason. Change is happening in every corner of human endeavor, without pattern, at a rate never before seen. There is no coordinating mechanism, no roadmap, not even a recognizable trend line. A beautiful chaos is transforming the fabric of human civilization. Now, there's no shortage of pessimism out there today in all manner of media. Trolls abound, challenges are omnipresent to be sure. But at .next, we think you'd be mistaken to view these as portents of an existential threat. They are rather the birth pangs of a new order, a new way of living that will break down the old categories and expose outdated mythologies. We have chosen to believe at .next that a transcendent future is emerging around us and within us. We don't expect to be able to predict its course, but it is our goal to document its arrival. Our focus is not on the grand gesture, the driverless car in the next 5 years, say, or the manned mission to Mars in 15 years. No, we have chosen to focus on the radical incrementalism of everyday genius. We seek minds that have taken to a disruptive approach to an entrenched modality that has outlived its usefulness cycle. And that is the perfect way to describe tonight's speaker, Donald Ian McCaw. 7 years ago, Donald stumbled on a glaring contradiction, namely, that the world of art pretends to worship originality, but it has actually changed very little in the past 500 years, or indeed in the last 35,000 years, if you take the long view. Innovation, it would seem, had been most stubbornly resisted in the area where it ought most to have been eagerly embraced. Not content merely to remark on this paradox, McCaw chose to do something about it. He set up a company, Mba Fabrications Incorporated, and developed a new approach to fine art production. He has shown that profitable art is possible without inspiration, without message, without artists even. Later on, we're going to give you a chance to ask questions, so please feel free to take notes. But right now, please join me, .next magazine, and the Summerworks Theater Festival in welcoming Mr. Donald Ian McCaw.
On the morning of January 24th, 1848, James W. Marshall was walking alongside the American River in the Coloma Valley in north central California. It was an area he'd become very familiar with since being hired 4 months earlier to supervise construction of a sawmill there. Now, the project, unfortunately, had been a bit of a bust from the very beginning. And that morning was starting out no differently. Once again, instructions that he had left the night before had not been followed to his satisfaction. So feeling a little dejected, he found himself looking down into the river when he saw something glistening just below the surface. And as he bent down to investigate, he felt a deep pulse of excitement. He knew just enough about geology to recognize that he had found gold, two nuggets of 23-karat gold, as it turned out, lying loose among the pebbles in the riverbed. Now, Marshall's great good fortune that day turned out to be the exact opposite for his employer, because that sawmill never got built. Within a week, every single member of the construction crew had quit to pan for gold in the shallow streams of north central California. Within a year, 300,000 men had poured into the area to do the same. The great California gold rush was on. Now, I remember reading the story of James W. Marshall when I was a young teenager, but I didn't get its full significance at the time. It wasn't until much later I realized it had sunk deep into my subconscious and changed the way I look at the world, leaving me with a kind of permanently divided attention. So as I embarked on my business career, I found that regardless of what I was working on at any given time, part of me was always scanning the environment, looking for an opportunity of historic importance hidden in plain sight. I had come to believe it was possible to look at what everyone else was looking at and see what no one else could see. Now, it's one thing to believe that something's possible. It's another thing, again, for it to actually happen. But 7 years ago, I had my own personal California Gold Rush moment. I'd like to say it was as dramatic as Marshall's, but it wasn't. It was more like a random observation, and at first I didn't know what to do with it. But over time it caught hold of me, and it became my obsession and my life's work and the reason I'm here to talk to you this evening. Now, my personal California Gold Rush moment actually happened 32,000 feet up in the air. I was in a plane flying from Toronto to New York on business, and I was flipping through the Times. And my eye fell on an article that was summarizing an auction that had been held at Sotheby's two nights earlier, so on June 25th, 2008. And I don't know why I paid attention, actually, because I had no interest in art at the time. I think it was all the dollar signs, because the article was basically a list of works and then a comparison of how much they'd been expected to sell for and how much they'd actually sold for. And there was one painting in particular that caught my attention that night, and it was called Verre et Poire, or as you might say in English, a glass and some pears. And it was far from the most expensive painting to sell that evening. It sold for about $8 million. But there were two things about it that really piqued my attention. First of all, it was painted by someone I'd never heard of before. Now, I knew you'd laugh, because you look at that right away and you say, Paul Cézanne. But I consider myself a fairly culturally aware person. I could recognize a Van Gogh to see one, a Picasso, a Dali. I just didn't know who Paul Cézanne was. It was kind of one of those names that's sort of familiar, but if you told me he was the French Minister of Defense at the outbreak of World War II, I'd have believed you. But there was more to it than that. Second thing was that the painting was very small. So it was just 7.5 inches high by 15.25 inches wide. So it intrigued me that someone had paid $8 million for a tiny painting by an obscure artist. So I took out a pen, and in the margin of the New York Times, I began to calculate the return on investment of this painting. So I knew how much it had sold for. It sold for just over $8 million. But to make that calculation, I needed to know how much it cost to produce in the first place. So off the top of my head, I just made a guess, and I said, time, materials for a very tiny painting, let's say $50 it cost. So I took the small number and divided it into the large number, and it turned out the return on equity was 16,000,000%. So I'm sitting there thinking, 16,000,000%? I checked my math, I count up the zeros, but that's what it is. I actually laughed out loud. Now, you have to understand something about me. In my business life, if someone comes to me with an opportunity that has a 100% return on equity, I will run, not walk, to take advantage of it. I will break down any obstacle that stands between me and a 100% return on equity. The idea that anywhere there was a business with a 16,000,000% return on equity blew my mind. And it got me thinking. I thought, so what did this person buy for $8 million? And I think if you asked a lot of people, they would say, masterpiece by French genius. But I have maybe a more practical turn of mind, and I think what he bought was four pieces of wood, a strip of fabric you probably couldn't make a pot holder out of, and a few grams of pigment smeared on the surface. And I thought, this is crazy. There's never been a business like this in the history of the world. The materials are so humble and the technology so primitive, yet the pricing seems infinitely elastic. So I was excited, but the plane eventually landed and I went about my business in New York. But by the time I got back to Toronto, it was kind of all I could think about, the case of Verre Poire. And so whenever an idea takes a hold of me, I like to talk to people about it. I like to get an idea out there and see how it navigates the world of ideas. And one of the friends I talked to was an old business school classmate of mine, and he has this amazing gift for cutting through the superficial on any issue and getting to the heart of the matter. So he started off by asking me a couple of questions. He said, "Don, are you thinking of getting into the art business?" And I said, "Yes." Just one syllable kind of popped out of my mouth. I hadn't even said it to myself yet, but it was evidence that I was interested. And then he went on, he said, "So what are you thinking of doing? You want to be a gallerist or a dealer or a speculator?" And I said, "No, I want to make the paintings." Because I walk around with this idea that if you truly understand the lowest cost at which a good can be produced and the highest price it can command in the market, that everything in between is just friction that can be eliminated with the application of solid business principles. Or let me put it another way for you. When you find out there's a business with a 16,000,000% return on equity, you realize you can afford to be very, very wrong about many, many things and still make a tremendous amount of money. So he said, he sensed I was excited, and it's his style to want to put the brakes on something like that. And so he said, "Listen, you've got to think of a few things. Anytime you want to take an idea and turn it into a business, you want to first of all understand if there are ingredients, systems, personalities that can't be easily duplicated on an industrial scale." And he said, "In the case of Verre Poire, the issues are talent and time." Now, in terms of talent, I've got to tell you something, first of all. I look at the painting, I don't think it's that good. Like, if you look at the glass on the right, isn't it kind of tilting towards the left in a way that doesn't make sense with the rest of the painting? It's as if a stiff wind is blowing in from the right and bending it like a birch tree. So anyway, that's just me. I'm not impressed. I do understand from people who know these things better than I do that Cézanne was a master manipulator of paint. I also get that he was a prime influence on the young Pablo Picasso, and the art world pays up for influence. So I understand that.
The second issue was time.
There's always a gap between when a product is produced and when the producer gets paid. And generally in business, you want to shrink that gap to as narrow a time span as possible. Now, there are exceptions to that. The wine business would be the most obvious one, where you can create a bottle, and if you store it for 3 years, it will sell for much more 3 years later than it would have originally, even when you subtract the costs associated with keeping it around. Now, it's awesome that Verre Poire returned a 16,000,000% return on equity, but it was finished in the year 1880, and that sale took place in 2008. That's 128 years. That's a lot of delayed gratification if you're looking at starting a business. And then he took another tack. So he said, "Talent and time are problems, and we came to call that the Cézanne conundrum." But then he took another tack, and he said, "I want you to think about the people on the Forbes list of the 400 richest individuals in the world. Think about the houses they live in, offices they work in, the hotels they stay in, the clubs they belong to. They are surrounded by the greatest art ever produced. You think none of them have noticed the yawning chasm of opportunity between the low, low cost of production and the high, high price of acquisition? If there was any kind of business opportunity there, those very capable individuals would have taken advantage of it a long time ago." And I'd actually had a similar thought, but I phrased mine different. I thought, how had it come to pass that the most insanely lucrative, profitable business in the history of the world had come to be in the hands of artists, probably the least business-like people in the history of the world? So I was noodling on these things. I had my own skepticism. But I knew that the art market is not just one painting selling on one occasion. It's made up of thousands of transactions every year, decade after decade. And I knew I needed to learn more. So I got myself an ArtNet online subscription, and I started pouring through auction data. So this painting had sold at Sotheby's in June of 2008, so I started working from there backwards in time, just looking at paintings. And one thing I was looking for in particular was a rebuttal to the Cézanne conundrum, to the challenges of talent and time. And it actually didn't take me long to find the perfect answer. And it was from a Christie's sale in February of 2008, so just 4 months earlier. And it was a work by Damien Hirst. Now, if you've heard of Damien Hirst, it might be because he once took a 14-foot tiger shark and suspended it in a vat of formaldehyde and called it the physical impossibility of death in the mind of someone living. But I have to tell you, Damien Hirst is more than just a glorified taxidermist. He creates a number of bodies of work, and one of those is known as the spot paintings. Now, the spot paintings are exactly what they sound like. They're paintings with a lot of spots on them. And for some reason, he decided to name them after chemical compounds
from an old pharmacology manual.
So the painting that was of specific interest to me, you see it here on the screen, was called Sarcosine Antihydride. And it seemed, as I said, to be the perfect rebuttal to the challenge of talent and time. Now, in terms of talent, it seems like Damien Hirst went to enormous effort to proclaim there was no skill involved in the making of these paintings. And let me explain it to you. If you go up close to one of them and you're looking for subtle shading or beautiful texture, you won't find it. These are very flat discs of color. I remember thinking myself, I saw one of these in a gallery, and I thought, I'm smarter. I get what's going on here. These aren't spots on the painting. These are pixels. And if I back up far enough, those pixels are going to resolve into a picture of a tree or a lady or something. But I got to tell you, I kept backing up, and there's spots as far as the eye can see. There's nothing going on there. It's completely random. The paintings themselves aren't made in oils or even artist's acrylics. They're executed in plain old household enamel. And Hirst himself is on record saying that after the first 10 or 12 of these, and keep in mind, there have been 1,600 of them produced since he started. After the first 10 or 12, every one of them has been executed by one of his studio assistants. So Hirst isn't even involved at all personally. In fact, all he does is come along at the end and affix a signature to the back. And from what I've been told, it's a pretty disinterested signature at that. So talent didn't seem to be an issue. In terms of time, this painting, Sarcosine Antihydride, was painted in 2006 and sold early in 2008. At most, it was 2 years old. So suddenly I saw talent not an issue, time not an issue. So I did what I now did, always did when I saw a painting that interested me. I calculated the return on equity. So I knew it had sold for just under $1.7 million that night at Christie's. And I now had to figure out how much it cost to make. So I was using as my benchmark my calculation for Verre et Poire. So if Verre et Poire costs $50 to make, Sarcosine Antihydride, which is a much bigger painting, 5 feet 6 inches by 5 feet 2 inches, is exactly 36 times bigger than Verre et Poire. So if Verre et Poire costs $50 to make, then Sarcosine Antihydride costs $1,800 to make. So I once again divided the small number into the big number, and I came up with a 94,000% return on equity. Now, at any other time in my life, I would have fallen over at the prospect of a 94,000% return on equity. But you have to understand, I'm now walking around thinking 16,000,000% is possible, so I'm actually underwhelmed by the 94,000% return on equity of this painting. But of course, it's not fair to compare what Verre et Poire achieved in 128 years with what Sarcosine Antihydride achieved in 2 years. So the way you make a true apples-to-apples comparison is to calculate the compound average annual rate of return. So slightly more complex math, but well within my skill set. So when I did the calculations, it turns out that Verre et Poire generated 9.89% on average over 128 years. And just think of those 128 years. Two world wars, a major depression, several minor recessions, no end of natural disasters. I don't know if any of you are investment bankers or asset managers here tonight, But 9.89% a year over 128 years, that is jaw-dropping performance. That is amazing. So then I made the same calculation for sarcosine antihydride, and it turns out in its two-year existence, it returned an average return of 2,490% per year. 2,490%. So that is an amazing financial performance. And the interesting thing is, it's not like this is a secret. I didn't have access to privileged information. This information is out there for anyone to calculate. And so now I'm passionately on fire to be in the art business. I've learned everything I need to know. I've got the rebuttal to the Cézanne conundrum. A painting does not have to have been created 100 years ago, and it does not have to be the work of a skilled genius. And so it was now time to start a company. So I'm standing there in front of a blank canvas, so to speak. I'm going to start a company from scratch. And I have to tell you, like most business people, I consider myself more of an imitator than an innovator. I have no interest in building something up by myself from scratch. I'd rather take something that's already working and tinker with it a little bit. So the challenge for me was to say, what existing business most closely resembles what I imagine the fine art production business will be like? And the answer I came up with was luxury goods manufacturing. So I'm thinking of companies that you'd be familiar with, like Versace, Gucci, Chanel. And these businesses are very interesting because they operate on something that you would call the genius model. So there's, first of all, a very standard, old-fashioned business component that's finance, marketing, accounting, human resources. And then grafted onto this is the freewheeling creative side, usually centered around the office of the creative director, the person who's responsible for the brand personality, the company genius. So I thought, when I look at making fine art, I can take care of all the standard business functions, no problem. I can do that stuff in my sleep. But I don't have a creative bone in my body. So I'm going to have to hire someone to be my creative director. I'm going to have to hire an artist who can bring that skill set into our partnership. So I hired an executive search firm, and I said, we need to find someone. And the person we're looking for is an artist whose work exhibits a high degree of polish, but whose career has not yet achieved a high degree of public profile. So they did their research, they networked within the community, and they identified 10 candidates. And you know, in every executive search situation, there are two things you're looking for. You're looking for technical qualification. So can the person do the job? Do they have the required skill sets and education? And then personality fit. So I had no ability to judge whether the person was qualified. I trusted that the search firm would take care of that. But I was really concerned about personality fit. So what I did was I either attended all the interviews or I remotely linked in if I was out of town or otherwise occupied. And it was kind of a frustrating process. I'm thinking, I'm going to have to work very closely with this person to build a business, and I need to know that we're speaking the same language. And I heard lots of crazy stuff. Like, we had one artist say, and I'm going to quote this word for word, he said, I'm increasingly troubled by the colonial implications of the traditional brushstroke. I thought, what? Like, you have a complicated relationship with your life's work. I don't know if it's going to work out between you and me. But there was more than that. One of the things I take as non-negotiable in my business dealings is that we are a company known for on-time delivery. So one of the questions we asked of all of our artist candidates, one of the questions we asked was, how do you know when a painting is done? And we had one woman say, I listen to the painting, and the painting tells me when it's done. And I thought, oh my gosh. Like, I don't know much about art, but I can tell you one thing. In the company that I start, the paintings aren't going to tell us what to do. We're going to tell the paintings what to do. So I instinctively hit the pause button. I said, you know what, maybe I've got something wrong, and maybe fine art production is not really a luxury goods business. Maybe it's an old-fashioned consumer products business. And I immediately felt a sense of relief because I worked in consumer products early in my career, and I was very well acquainted with the golden rule. And the golden rule is find out what the public wants and give it to them. And it made me think right away, you know, does this maybe explain the problems with the art business? You know, there was a survey done by the California Artists Alliance back in 2002. It's referred to a lot. And what they found from among their members is they asked them to assign a cost value to their paintings. So materials plus their labor at the current minimum wage. And what they found out is, first of all, 64% of the paintings created by their members, remember, these are professionals, never sell. Another 20% sell for a level below even materials plus minimum wage. And at the top, there's 8%. 8% of the work of the members of the California Artists Alliance sell at a level that any other business person would call profitable. So when you think about why that would be, imagine the typical artist in their studio. So they're working away, they're isolated, they're pushing themselves to create something to follow their muse, to satisfy their own standards. And what they do is, what we would call in marketing, it's a push strategy. They push that onto the market. So it's an inherently autocratic approach. Now imagine consumer goods, where you're finding out what people want and giving it to them. What you're really saying is, we want the market to pull from us what it wants. I think that's an inherently democratic process. So my challenge was going to be, how do I find out what the market wants? And you know, the usual approach is based on something called the self-reporting paradigm. So you might have participated in surveys before where someone says, do you like this product? Would you like it in this color or that color? Would you pay this much or that much for it? But it's based on a flawed understanding of human decision making. It assumes that people understand their own motivations and can predict their own behavior. But all of the science says that's not true. Decision making is not a rational, deliberative process that happens in the frontal cortex. It's something that happens down here. So you can't ask people their opinions on a product and ask how they would respond to it, because they don't know. So the way you find out is through an approach that we found at a company called A&M Ideascape. And what A&M Ideascape does is they take a look into the motivational core of the individual when subjected to stimuli. So their approach is to use biometrics, which sounds fancy, but really anyone who's been to a doctor's office would recognize the tools of their trade. They use heart rate monitoring and blood pressure monitoring to determine how people are responding. And heart rate and blood pressure are really fascinating because they're both connected to emotion, but they're not connected to each other. So what happens is, for example, your heart rate can go up, but your blood pressure stay the same or even drop. And vice versa. Blood pressure can go up, heart rate can stay the same or go down. So what it provides is truly stereoscopic vision into the emotional response of an individual
when subjected to a stimulus. So we said,
can you design an experiment for us to help us determine what people like? And what they did was they assembled a list of the 50 greatest artists by auction results in the years between 1950 and 2000. And for each of those artists, they created a 3-minute slideshow. So they would bring 10 people in at a time, hook them up to the biometrics, and show them one 3-minute slideshow, and then another, and then another. And they would show them about 10. Now, what they found is people can look at art for about half an hour, and then they really fall asleep. It was interesting. In the lab, there was a person whose only job is to go around and wake people up when they're falling asleep. So that's part of it. So we were getting numerical data on emotional response from heart rate and blood pressure, and those were fed onto a timeline that coincided with what art they were looking on at the time. So if there was a little bump in the response, then you would know, say if it happened at the minute and a half mark, oh, that's Agnes Martin that caused that. Or if it happened at 18 minutes and 30 seconds, oh, that's Marlene Dumas who created that. So what they would do then is, after they'd spent their time in the lab, they would go to a separate room with a facilitator who would talk to them about their experience, not saying, do you like this, what would you pay for, but just getting them to share memories, impressions from what they saw, so that we had some subjective data to go along with the objective somatic data that was coming from heart rate and blood pressure. And what we wanted to do was take those 50 artists, rank them from 1 to 50 in terms of emotional engagement, so that in the end, we could see who was at the top, and we could take elements from maybe the top 2 or 3 artists and combine them into a unique hybrid. So I'm gonna show you the results we got. They were really fascinating. So what we did was, if we just look here at the first 5 of those artists, we'll see that number one on the list was Bridget Riley. Now, Bridget Riley is a British painter, came to prominence in the 60s. She was a real anomaly because she was the only woman on our list in the top five. In fact, she was the only woman in the top 12 for some reason, and she was the only non-figurative painter. So she's an abstract painter. Now, we looked at the work, and I have to tell you, A&M Ideascape, they're looking at emotional engagement. I'm looking at three things, really: labor efficiency, and labor efficiency. So I had come to look at paintings on a
effort per square inch basis.
I was interested to look at that whole surface area and say, how much is it going to cost me labor-wise to get that thing produced? So I'm looking at these, and I'm thinking, that looks like it was made by a computer. I think we could probably save a lot of money if we make paintings with a computer. But it wasn't that simple. What we thought was emotional engagement turned out to be something else. It turns out that the closely registered wavy lines and the low resolution of the LCD projector in the lab was actually putting our test subjects into optical distress. So what we thought was emotional engagement was really low-level anxiety. So we had to throw that result out. But we just continued down the line. The next on the list was George Kondo. Now, if you had to describe George Kondo's work, you would say it's maybe a combination of a mid-70s Mad Magazine vibe with a pansexual perversity, or what one of our analysts called wildly uncommercial work. So we kept going down the list, and it didn't get much better. Leon Golub, an American painter from Chicago, specializes in scenes of interrogation and torture. Robert Longo depicts men who seem to be caught at the moment of being shot. And Philip Guston, originally a Canadian, but later made his home in the United States, he was originally an abstract painter, but later in life became a figurative painter, featuring a recurring character who would wear a Ku Klux Klan hood and smoke a lot. So it was a really depressing moment for us. Because what we had, our top five artists that we were going to build our company around, what we had in the top five was four antisocial agitators and a woman whose paintings actually hurt people. So you'd think, you know what? Why not just go down the list, six, seven, eight? Eventually you'll find something to work with. But the drop-off in terms of emotional response was very steep after number five. So we had artists who barely budged the needle at all. In fact, some of them actually reduced the vital signs of observers and put them into what A&M Ideascape called a somnolent state. So for us, very depressing. The picture is hazy. We don't know what we're going to do. But the A&M Ideascape, who we were working with, they're very comfortable taking a hazy picture and bringing some focus to it. And what they did was they looked at the subjective data, and they came back to us and said, you know what? People don't see the Robert Longo figures as victims of violence. They see them as either dancing, which I guess if you came of age in the 80s, you might think, yeah, that's dancing. Or they see them as expressing passion, whatever that means. But it was something positive. And so it caused us to look closer at the work of Robert Longo. And remember, I'm now looking at effort per square inch. And I'm noticing if you look at that, say, the third painting from the left, or the third work from the left, you'll notice that a lot of it is background, just plain, unadored background. The foreground is dominated by a compound shape made up of the jacket, the tie, the pants, the shoes, and the socks. Only 8% of the image, the hand at the top, the shirt in the middle, the hand on the left side, requires any level of detail work. So now I'm really excited. I'm thinking, this is something that we can work with from a labor efficiency perspective and from a popularity, because he's in our top five. But I knew we couldn't just make Robert Longo style images. We'd have to do some work, find something else to integrate to make it different and unique. So we kept going down the list until at number 34, we came across Patrick Caulfield. Patrick Caulfield, a British painter, now deceased, came to prominence in the 60s, and his work features peopleless interiors and still life. So we never would have noticed him except for that piece on the right, which is called The Portrait of Juan Gris. But I just called it a dumpy guy in a suit. But the fact that he was wearing a suit kind of linked up with what we'd seen in Robert Longo. We thought, that's the pivot. And suddenly I'm thinking, we have a formula here. We have a Robert Longo style figure. So what we came to call a man in a suit in action. And then we could use with that Patrick Caulfield's visual vocabulary. So solid blocks of color and bold outline. And they seemed like a natural fit to go together. Now, just because you can say, let's put the work of Robert Longo and Patrick Caulfield together, doesn't mean you actually know how to do it. So what we did was we decided to call our creative director candidates back in for a second round of interviews. This would be the practical round. And what we did was we just set the challenge up before them. We said, if you had to combine the work of Robert Longo and Patrick Caulfield, what would you do? So we had a great outpouring of ideas, what brushes to use, paints, what relative humidity to keep the production facility at to maximize the cure rate of the painting. And we had one artist in particular tell us about her process, and I'm going to share it with you in some detail because it's important to where we go with this. She's a landscape painter, and her process is to find a scene that she likes, take a photograph, take that photograph, blow it up, put a piece of clear Mylar on top, and just make a simple tracing of the photographed image. Once she has the finished drawing, she scans it into a computer graphics program and outputs it to an adhesive vinyl stencil cutter. What the adhesive vinyl stencil cutter does is create basically a big sticker that can be applied to any two-dimensional surface and has the image cut into it by a computer-controlled knife. So what she then does is she'll take off the vinyl for the trees, paint, paint, paint green. When it dries, put it back on. Take off the bark of the trunk, paint it brown. When it dries, put that back, and so on for the grass, the rocks, the sky. At the end, she takes all that vinyl off, and she has a very crisply executed painting. Everything is perfectly clean edge, not because she has great manual dexterity, but because with the stencil, you can't actually paint outside of the lines. So we heard this process and we started thinking, you know, we had always assumed that we would use artists to do the work at the facility, but one of the people working with me said, listen, there's nothing about her process that requires skill at all. Think about it. That initial photograph doesn't have to be expertly lit or cleverly processed. It just has to be sharply focused. As for the drawing, anyone can make a tracing with good eyesight and a steady hand. After that, it's into the scanner, out to the adhesive vinyl stencil maker, and then placed on the two-dimensional surface where anyone could apply the paint. So we're thinking, you know what, we won't need artists to do this work. We can hire unskilled laborers, which won't save us a lot of money, but will save us a little bit. And I gotta tell you, in any new business, every little savings counts, because sometimes that's the margin between making it and not making it. So we would use unskilled laborers to make the work, but then we're thinking, why stop there? Do we actually need a creative director to be in charge, or just a regular operations manager who's focused on efficiency? And with that, we realized we had dodged a bullet, that we wouldn't have a creative director as the genius at our company. The business model itself would be the genius, capable of pumping out an infinite variety of poses within the framework that we had established. So we would focus on process, and what would happen now is our company wouldn't have that danger that those fashion companies have, which is, you know, if you have a creative director, you've got two worries if that person's successful. First of all, you're worried that they're going to leave. They're going to walk out the door with basically your brand equity. But you're also kind of worried that they're going to stay, because if your product has become over-identified with their particular skill set, basically, they have you by the throat. They can ask for whatever they want. You can't afford to let them go, because in a very real sense, they are the company. But at Mba Fabrications, the business process was going to be the genius. And so we contacted all the creative director candidates and told them we wouldn't be proceeding with the hire, and we moved forward. It was finally time to make some paintings because we knew what our process was. So we opened up an R&D facility just northwest of the city in Toronto, and we began making paintings. So there's a lot of trial and error involved in the process. And with us, we started out with a pose called Innocence. So you can see it just appearing on the screen here. And if you look at it, you'll notice it's a figure, but there's no head, and there's a reason for that. We'd found earlier on that even though you think tracing is easy, it can be problematic. And I know I was worried because a number of the creative director candidates had told us that hands are the hardest thing for people to paint or for artists to create. And I knew that, kind of, because back when I was doing my research through the auction results, I'd become a very big fan of Francis Bacon since he sold his 1976 triptych for $49.4 million back in 2008. I say he sold it, he was gone by then, but someone made a lot of money on that. But when I looked at Francis Bacon's work in more detail, I had read an article that said, always notice he can't do hands. He either obscures them or fudges them. And I thought, well, if he can't do it, it may be a problem. Because, you know, Francis Bacon's kind of well known, very good with teeth, not so good with hands. So, and I'm telling you, if any of you have a tablet here or a smartphone, and you want to just quickly look up a Francis, I defy you to show me after this session tonight a painting where he executes hands in an accurate way. But our person could do that. They couldn't do heads. They couldn't do heads that didn't look cartoonish. So we thought, at first, maybe we're going to have to give in. We're going to have to hire an artist to come in and actually do the faces. But by this stage, that was like anathema to us. Anything but hire an artist. So we just decided in the end, we'll just cut the heads off and there won't be any heads in our paintings. And it actually worked out quite well. So we worked on integrating the figure and worked on making paintings. We did a lot of different examples. But we had a person who was a part of our team, and that person was our intellectual property lawyer. And anytime you're trying to do something unique, your intellectual property lawyer is your best friend. That's the person who makes sure that you can't get sued for copying someone else, and that you can sue the pants off of anyone who tries to copy you. So he said to us, you know what, I see what you're trying to do. You're combining the Robert Longo thing and the Patrick Caulfield thing, but they still look too much like Robert Longo works. And I've got to tell you, if I was Robert Longo's lawyer, I'd sue you and I'd win. So you got to change it up. And so we tried, as you can see on the screen here, a lot of different backgrounds, but they were either expensive to produce or our employees couldn't do them on a consistent basis. And he said, you know what, you're trying too hard. And this guy has this little accessory. You know, he's a very corporate Bay Street guy, but he walks around with this sample book. And the sample book is for MacTac drawer liners. Now, I don't know if any of you remember MacTac. It was this kind of sticky wallpaper kind of stuff that you put in a drawer to, I guess, make sure that the surface is clean. So he walks around with this book and he says, I'm a big fan of pattern. He said, we often think that of a trademark as applying to a company name, a slogan, a mascot, but you can trademark a pattern. And the most famous example of that is by Burberry. It's called the Haymarket Check, and you'll recognize it on the screen there. They include it in every product, and they are very intense about protecting that trademark. I would venture to guess if someday on the train you accidentally sketched out the Haymarket Check on a piece of paper, that a lawyer would appear over your shoulder and serve you with a cease and desist order. Like, they are that intense about it. And the reason is simple. It is their brand equity. It's their number one identifier of their product. So he said, why don't you flip through the MacTac book? This is all public domain. They never trademarked any of it. Find a pattern, integrate it with what you do. If I can get a trademark, you're safe. You can't be touched. So we looked through the book, and eventually we found this pattern of circles. And we modified it slightly. And we actually got a trademark on it. It's called, if you look it up, it's registered in Canada, the US, all of Europe now, and parts of Asia where enforcement regimes are strong enough. And it's called MBA Nested Circles. And we're the only ones who can use it. And so we now had a third component to our formula. So we had the Patrick Longo, or pardon me, Robert Longo style figures, the Patrick Caulfield visual vocabulary, and the MBA Nested Circles pattern integrated into every painting we make. So that took some experimentation, but eventually we got there and we created the very first painting where we brought everything together. It was that pose that I talked to you about, the Innocence pose, and it proved to be very successful and the beginning of us making a lot of different paintings, always using those same three components. So always the man in a suit in action, always solid blocks of color and bold outlines, always with the MBA nested circles integrated into the design. And in June 2010, we had a very momentous day, and that was the day we sold our very first painting. It was less by like 6 days, maybe, less than 2 years from when I first had that experience of flying to New York and looking at the results, the auction results in the New York Times. So I was very proud that we had come that far, that fast. Now,
I was in San Francisco 6 months ago making a presentation very much like this to a group of young entrepreneurs. And when the conference was over, I asked one of the hosts if he would drive me out to Coloma, California. Now, if you remember, Coloma, California is the place where James W. Marshall found those two nuggets of 23-karat gold all those years ago. And since then, Coloma, California has become something of a tourist destination, dominated by this giant statue of James W. Marshall pointing at the spot where he made his discovery. And if you saw that statue, you might be forgiven for thinking that he probably died an extremely wealthy man in a palatial mansion surrounded by family and admirers. But there is another attraction in Coloma, California, and it's called the Marshall Cabin. And what it really is a broken down shack where Marshall lived his final days alone, sick, and impoverished, his pension cut off by the state of California that he had done so much to found. When I looked at that cabin, I stood there, it was kind of a poignant moment for me. It made me think how often people who arrive early at some new discovery fail to actually benefit from it at all. And you don't have to go back to the middle of the 19th century to see that. Any student of recent business history will know that before Facebook, there was Friendster. Before iTunes, there was Napster. It's a phenomenon that we used to talk about actually in business school, and we called it the first is worst phenomenon. I have a friend of mine, in fact, it was the same friend who kind of detailed the Cezanne conundrum for me earlier on in my process. And he said, Don, aren't you worried that you're the first to take a truly corporate approach to producing fine art? And I said, you know what? I'm not worried at all. I think one of the worst things you can do in business or in life is to look at the past and learn the wrong lessons. James W. Marshall didn't die a broken man, and Napster and Friendster didn't file for bankruptcy because there's some mysterious curse on coming first. They failed because they didn't focus on creating a real business structure, a solid business structure around what later turned out to be very important discoveries. I know a lot of you may be disappointed tonight. You came out to hear a lecture on art, and what you heard is actually a lot about labor efficiency and return on equity. I have to say, I didn't get into the art business because I thought the world needed more art. As I said earlier, most art that's produced never even sells. I can't say that I got into the business because I think the world needs better art. People have said, maybe that's the problem. Maybe art doesn't sell because it's not good enough. And as a corporate executive, you need to focus on making the product better and better and better. And all I can say to that is, really? Like, Damien Hirst has made a fortune painting small dots of color on a white background. Or rather, he's made a fortune paying someone to paint small dots of color on a white background. If you look back in art history in the late 50s, Eve Klein shocked the art world by creating canvases covered completely in ultramarine blue from top to bottom, edge to edge. Just one color. Robert Ryman made a whole career out of creating paintings that are just white top to bottom, edge to edge, and white's not even a color. So I'm very confident our paintings are plenty good enough. The art world doesn't need more paintings. The world doesn't need better paintings. The art world needs a better business model. And since I became acquainted with the possibilities on that flight to New York all those years ago, I've made it my obsession and my life's work. And it's the reason I was asked to come and talk to you this evening. So thank you very much for listening.
Audience questions in just a moment, but a few things popped up for me during the lecture, and I just wanted to talk to you about them. Now, I could talk bottom lines all night, but this is an arts festival, so I thought it might be useful to back up a little bit and discuss your background in the arts. You mentioned at the top of the lecture not recognizing the I'm forgetting his name.
Cezanne.
The Cezanne. I'm curious, before your business endeavor into art, did you have a relationship to art itself? Do you remember a painter or paintings that affected you?
No. What I do remember is You know, as I was working my way up the corporate ladder in the business world, I learned pretty early on that you have to be able to talk with all kinds of people. So some of your customers are going to be sports fans. You need to know about sports. You need to be conversant with the game the night before. And other people are into traveling. You need to know about the various destinations that are out there. But some people are actually interested in art. So I made it a point of mine to actually learn a little bit about art. So that's why I would know a Van Gogh or a Picasso or a Dali to see one. But my research was not super thorough. I was looking to be able to make superficial conversation with business clients. So that's really the only interest in art I had, I would say.
When you look at a new work from a new MBA fabrication, when you look at it, what do you feel? Do you feel anything, or is it
what's
your response to it?
I feel there's another $6,000 coming our way when I see one of our paintings.
That's great.
So, like, because I have to tell you something, and our marketing manager's here tonight. She doesn't like me saying this, but I don't actually like our paintings. So, which is, you know, it sounds terrible, but we have research.
I don't like them either, particularly.
Right. Which doesn't offend me, because our research shows that 88% of people, it's called the indifference ratio. Our indifference ratio is 88%.
So, it's fantastic.
88% of people are going to look at our paintings and feel nothing, or actually feel aversion to them. But 12%. And if you are one of those 12% and you saw the images flashing on the screen tonight, you know who you are. You couldn't take your eyes off them. And while 12% seems small, in the world of business response, that's an amazing performance. We're very proud of it. So the fact that I'm in the 88%, and apparently you are too, who don't really like the images, is actually, I think, an advantage for me, because it allows me to be objective about what we're doing. I think if there's one problem in the art world as I see it, it's there's too much love. Like, you think of the people who get into art. So they're in school as young people. They're different. They're not great at sports. And when they graduate, they kind of band together, sharing that love of art. But the problem, if you love what you do too much, you lose your objectivity. And so I think if there's been a strength for us as a company, it's because I've kept the objectivity, because I'm not in love with what we do.
Fascinating. Do we have a microphone for the audience questions, or how should we go about it? Does anyone, can we bring the house lights up, perhaps? Does anyone, let's start with some questions here.
Yes.
Yeah, what's been your gross profit over the last 7 years?
Well, you know what, I get asked that a lot. We're a private company, so the nice thing about being a private company is I don't have to answer that question.
Yeah, sure.
Anyone else? Over here.
I guess I'm curious about your pricing strategy. I mean, you were saying that the pieces are selling in the sort of $6,000 to $12,000 range right now.
Yes.
And I wasn't sure whether that was where they started, or whether you'd seen some gradual increase.
Oh, we've seen tremendous increase since the beginning. That's, you know, we've plotted out our financial projections. We've actually got a 30-year plan. Not a lot of companies have a 30-year plan, but it's a very sophisticated approach to, we do an asset banking program. So we actually we put two-thirds of what we produce into the market. We bank a third against the prospect of increasing valuations over the years. So we've already seen some increase, and we're not content to stay at 6 and 10. We really believe we can get to the $100,000 threshold and even the $1 million threshold.
Do you see different responses in the market in terms of the year in which something was produced? I mean, you were saying earlier that you'd aspire with something that didn't obviously differentiate, or wasn't obviously differentiated in terms of who made it or when it was made.
Oh yeah, the paintings are dated, and they're signed on the back by either me or Adnan Ali, who is our operations manager. But the signature isn't a traditional artist signature. What it is we've got a certificate of authenticity that is attached to the back of the painting. And so as a corporate officer, I sign to say that this is an actual verified piece of work by MBA Fabrications. But it's not traditionally a signature the way we think of it.
And you're seeing greater demand for the older pieces.
You know what, we sell everything we make, so I don't know. There's an aftermarket effect that we're beginning to see, so some appreciation there. But that's probably another 10 years off for us. So we're just looking at our retail price of the two-thirds of the product that we release into the market, and we've seen that grow in time. So that's right on trend for us to be where we want to be over the next decade.
Well, that's an innovative approach. Right here, I believe.
Yeah. Are you at all concerned about competition, imitators in your market segment?
No, you know what? It actually, I find it disappointing that we don't have competitors yet. When you look at, say, being a corporate approach, and you know, you go to any mall and you see this, you'll see a dress store, and then right beside it, another dress store. And intuitively, you think, well, you're just cannibalizing customers away from each other. But the way it works is that the two together actually generate more interest. So part of my objective in doing lectures like this is also to get, because I talk to a lot of business groups, is to get someone else interested in getting into this business and creating some critical mass around the idea of corporately produced fine art. Yes?
We have time for just a few more. We'll go.
I was just curious, have you had any success with granting bodies bringing you either subsidies or helping your business actually get off the ground? Or was it all just
Not granting bodies. We take advantage of some tax incentives because, so to say, to locate our production facility in Brampton, and actually the one we did in New Jersey, we got very attractive tax incentives to do that. But we don't do traditional grant applications that an artist would think of.
No, back there.
I'm interested in your material cost versus the return on investment. Being a performance festival, do you have any advice for the performance world?
Well, my number one advice to anyone in any art is to hire a good accountant and listen to that individual. And I'm not talking about an accountant as someone you would throw your receipts at and say, make sure my taxes get in on time. I'm talking about an accountant who can partner with you shoulder to shoulder to make sure that every decision you're making is financially responsible. I think that's the number one thing any arts-oriented person could do. So that's the advice that I would pass on.
Do these works show in exhibitions?
We do work with a guest. So we have a channel strategy. So we partner with different organizations who access the market. And we do show through the Anna Castera Gallery in New York. So they're our official representative in New York. So that's one channel. We do the art fairs. We'll either do them through the Castera Gallery or we'll do some direct to public. So it's kind of a mixed bag. We're very tactical in terms of addressing the market as opposed to having a fixed idea of how to do it.
Here in the front.
I just had a question. What's the profile of your clientele?
Our client is 48 to 72 years of age, and so we look to, because at the cost, it starts younger and then it gets older the more you're able to charge for your paintings, and so that person is obviously a person generally who has more than, I think we define it now as $124,000 of annual household income, but really we don't even perform well in that segment of the market. We're looking at $500,000 and up household disposable income.
We have time for one more question this evening. That's the first hand I saw, right there.
I just got to tip my hat to you, Serge. You're a man of vision. And,
thank you.
I'm one of that small percentage that really appreciates your paintings.
Thanks. And,
I just want to know where I can buy them.
Well, what you can do is you can look up Mba Fabrications online after, and you can send an inquiry to us. We try not to work over the heads of our channel partners, but if you make the inquiry at info@mbafabrications.com, we'll connect you with the reseller that most likely is going to be able to meet your needs, depending on location and the kind of price you're looking at.
Great. Don, thank you. On behalf of .next magazine and the Summerworks Performance Festival, thank you for coming tonight.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.